Okay, we are now beginning a very interesting section of Romans, Romans 9 through 11, where many people have felt that Paul is simply kind of giving an irrelevant aside in order to give certain special theological camps proof texts for their views. It's not really related to the flow of thought in Romans, they think, because the flow of thought was all about justification by faith and then, of course, a bit on sanctification, and it's not really about Israel. But suddenly Paul turns his attention to Israel, which is like unrelated. But as we've been trying to show, that Paul's whole thrust of most of the book of Romans is directed toward Israel and their misunderstanding of their standing with God. The assumptions that the Israelites have made is that because they are circumcised and of a separated race, that they are special to God, that they are his favorites. And Paul spent a lot of his earlier chapters trying to dismantle that particular sense of being different and different, standing before God on different terms than the Gentiles do. He makes it very clear that being circumcised, keeping the law, that's not what it commends a person to God. And therefore, a Gentile who doesn't do that is not necessarily at a disadvantage with God vis-a-vis a Jew who does do those things. And so the mentality of the Jew has been one of the things that Paul wants to address all along. It's true, in the process of doing so, he says things that are relevant to us all, but really the basic thing he has said all along is it's not the law, it's justification by faith, it's grace, it's the Spirit of God. And he even made it very clear that the law is not even necessary in order to live a holy life, but the Spirit of God is. So in a sense, he's replacing all of the assumptions that his Jewish readers have about themselves with a clearer picture of what God's really up to. Now, one of the assumptions the Jews had was, of course, that they as a race were to be saved. And that clearly has not yet happened because, well, most Jews are not Christians. And so Paul is going to try to address that issue. He has made it very clear that not only Jews are saved, Gentiles are too if they're believers. But now he's going to express why not all Jews even are. There are Jews and Gentiles who are saved. This has presented two surprises to the Jewish mind. One is that Gentiles also can be saved, and the other is that not all Jews are. In other words, God has never accepted people simply on the basis of their racial background. It has to do with one's faith. It has to do with one's, you know, loyalty to God. It has to do with other things besides ancestry and ritual. And so Paul now turns again to his Jewish reader to a large extent, I think, although at certain points in this discussion, he will address the Gentiles and warn them not to be too proud or too haughty about being, you know, grafted in to this tree. Most of this discussion is a correction to Jewish misunderstanding about the status of Israel and answering objections that they may have to Paul's position. He expects objections, as he has all the way through. Now, this is not like a new departure for him, because many of the things he's addressing here were actually raised as brief questions, and the answer was postponed till this point back in chapter 3. Because at the end of chapter 2, he had famously said, "He is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew who is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but from God." Then he said in chapter 3, verse 1, "What advantage then has the Jew? Or what is the profit of circumcision? Much in every way, chiefly because to them were committed the oracles of God. And when we get to chapter 9, he's going to point out that the Jews have had not only that, but a great number of other advantages that Gentiles have not had. He's going to list quite a few of them in Romans 9. And then, of course, he raises the question in verse 9, Romans 3, 9. What then? Are we better than they? That is, are we Jews better than those Gentiles? We've had advantages they didn't have. Has that made us better people? And he says, unfortunately not. We're about the same. Now, having talked about the Jews and what advantages they have and what their status is and so forth, Paul realizes that this is a much larger subject than can be dispensed with a few offhand sentences, as he did in chapter 3, the beginning of chapter 3. This needs much more elaboration. And just as I mentioned before, everything after about chapter 5 is expansion on things he said briefly in chapter 5. In the first five chapters. And so here also, this is an elaboration on something that he hinted at and spoke about, but without full discussion, back in chapter 2 and 3 especially. And what he's going to be addressing is, how can this be that actually God made promises to Israel, especially promises about their salvation, ultimate salvation, and yet we're talking about the Messiah has come and that he's brought salvation. And look, most of the Jews, most of Israel, haven't participated. They're not saved. How can this be if God said he's going to save Israel? And he's going to have this discussion three chapters long, chapters 9, 10, and 11. And toward the end of chapter 11, he's going to give this conclusion. Chapter 11, verse 26. He says, and so all Israel will be saved. Okay? Really, the underlying question in chapter 9 and following is, why isn't Israel saved if God has promised they will be? The answer finally he gets to is, all Israel will be saved. But notice that sentence, chapter 11, verse 26, begins with the word so. In the Greek, it means thus or in this way. There's two views that people have about this whole section, this discussion. The dispensational view seems to hold that Paul is saying, well, true, the Jews have not been saved. Israel has not been saved yet, but they will. This is an eschatological thing that we anticipate. You're just too early. Just be patient. It's going to happen. Eventually, the Jews will be saved. In the meantime, we just have to realize that God has his timing for everything, and it hasn't happened yet. That's one opinion. That's the dispensational opinion about Romans 9 through 11. The non-dispensational opinion about these chapters is that Paul is saying, you wonder why Israel isn't saved. Your problem is the way you're defining Israel. Because in fact, God has saved and is saving Israel in this way that you have not thought about. And so his answer in chapter 11, verse 26 is, in this way, all Israel will be saved. He's not saying when it'll happen. He's saying the method it'll happen. That the Jews, and maybe many Christians like dispensationalists, believe that Paul's only concerned about when it will happen. The discussion is about how it will happen. His conclusive statement is, in this way, Israel will be saved. Not at such and such a time, Israel will be saved. And of course, those who are dispensationalists actually understand, I think wrongly, chapter 11, verse 26, to be saying, then Israel will be saved. He talks about some things in the previous verse, the Gentiles coming in and so forth, and dispensationalists read verse 26, Romans 11, 26, as if Paul said, and then all Israel will be saved, as if he's talking about the time frame and the chronology, and it's going to happen later on and so forth. But he doesn't say then. There's no then in that sentence. There's no chronological indicator in that sentence. It's a methodological. In this way, he says, all Israel will be saved. So if God has promised that all Israel will be saved, he's doing it. And it's not a postponed thing. Of course, not all Israel has been saved yet because people are still being saved, but they've been being saved. God has been collecting the true Israel to himself and saving them since Jesus was here and continues to. And in this way, all the true Israel that ever will live in the future or in the past will all be gathered together into this salvation. But you have to understand what God means by Israel, because many Jews do not come into Christ. Many Jews reject Christ. And this is not a nullification of God's promise about Israel. It's simply You have to realize that not all are Israel who are of Israel. Not the Jews who do not receive Christ, they aren't really Israel. And God has another way of identifying Israel and those ones he truly is saving in the way that he intends to do and that Paul will explain. So we're going to be looking at this, realizing that many people, perhaps most people who teach Romans, they treat chapter 9 through 11 as most of all anticipating a future salvation of all the Jewish race near the end of the world, just before Jesus comes back. This is not the subject Paul's talking about. This section is not about eschatology. It's about soteriology. Eschatology means the doctrine of final things. This is not about that. I believe it's not about that. Soteriology is from the word soteria. It's the Greek word for salvation. This is the doctrine of how salvation takes place. And it will also be Israelology, the study of who Israel is. But these are different issues than eschatology. Whereas almost all people influenced by dispensationalism have thought this is an eschatological discussion about how God has in fact passed over Israel. God has not saved Israel, but he will. And therefore his promises to save Israel have not failed permanently. They have failed for the time being, but not permanently. That's the eschatological view of this. And that's not the view I understand Paul to be arguing. Let's look at what he actually says. Romans 9. I tell you the truth in Christ, I'm not lying. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. For I could wish that my brethren, I could wish I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh. My kinsmen according to the flesh would be his Jewish, fellow Jewish people of the race of Israel, of Jews. And he says, he basically is saying they clearly aren't saved. He would never think to wish himself a curse from Christ for their salvation if he assumed they already were saved. By the way, there are some people who teach that doctrine. There are very few, relatively, thankfully. The doctrine of dual covenant theology. John Hagee is fairly famous for teaching this doctrine, that God will save Jews on the basis of their faithfulness to the old covenant and Gentiles on the basis of the new covenant. What this boils down to is Jews that reject Jesus, but who keep the old covenant, God will save them on that basis because they're different than Gentiles. Jews are different than Gentiles. Well, one has to ask, has this person ever read Romans? Is there anything brought out more clearly in Romans than God saves Jews and Gentiles on exactly the same basis? And has he ever read what Jesus said to the Jews who were keeping the old covenant as best they understood it? But he said, you're of your father, the devil. And if you don't believe that I am he, you'll die in your sins. He didn't seem to indicate that, well, you can reject me since you're Jews, but you'll be saved if you just keep the laws of Moses. Jesus didn't teach that. And Christianity has never taught that. It's definitely a very false doctrine. And there are those who do teach it, that the Jews don't need Christ. They just need to follow Moses. Gentiles, on the other hand, need Christ, and therefore there's two groups, people being saved different ways. That's called dual covenant theology. I do not know very many Christians who teach it, but one of the ones who does is extremely well known from television and so forth, and that's John Hagee. Now, that doctrine is about as false as any doctrine I've ever heard taught in evangelicalism. It's a denial that the Jews need their Messiah, and that's pretty ridiculous, obviously. It's almost self-refuting. But if I need to refute it, I can on another occasion. I don't think anyone's going to have any problem seeing that if the Jews didn't need Jesus, then Jesus, when he preached them, was, beating a dead horse. And basically, there's no reason for him to work on them so hard and beg them to believe and come around and so forth. Anyway, or Paul either for that matter, because Paul definitely preached in the synagogues that the people need to believe in Jesus, and they were Jewish people he's preaching to. He says, I could wish myself accursed from Christ for my brethren. In other words, if they could be saved at the expense of my salvation, I'd make the trade. That's how much I want them saved. And that's how much I am convinced they are not currently saved. They're not saved just by being Jews. They need Jesus. They don't have him. I don't want to be accursed from Christ, but if that would guarantee the salvation of all those people, then I'd make that sacrifice. That's how much I care about them. Paul was not anti-Semitic. He loved the Jews. He was a Jew. Yet many things he taught kind of sound like if he had been a Gentile, we might argue that he was anti-Semite. You know, he says some very harsh things about the unbelieving Jews in some of his passages. We won't look at them now. But he says about his brethren in flesh, verse 4, they are Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, that's the temple service, the tabernacle service, and the promises, of whom, that is of Israel, are the fathers. They were of the nation of Israel, the family of Israel. The church, the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, were theirs. And from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all the eternally blessed God. Amen. Now, Christ is over all Jews and Gentiles, but he came from the Jews. So Paul is saying, look at all these advantages the Jews have had. They were adopted by God early on out of Egypt. They were given covenants, covenants plural. God gave the Abrahamic covenant to them, the Sinaitic covenant to them, the Davidic covenant. Even the new covenant was first made with the remnant of Israel. All the covenants pertain to Israel, depending on what we understand Israel to mean. And, you know, the giving of the law, that's an advantage he gave them. The service of God, that is, no other nation had a tabernacle that God ordained to be worshipped in, that they could worship God, the true God. The promises, God made promises to Israel, and that's the issue here. God promised to save Israel. Where? Oh, many times. I have a list here of verses I just printed out during the break from the Old Testament that all speak about God's promise to save Israel. Isaiah 45, 17. But Israel shall be saved by the Lord with an everlasting salvation. Okay, that's Isaiah 45, 17. Isaiah 46, 13. I bring my righteousness near. I shall not be far off. My salvation shall not linger, and I will place salvation in Zion for Israel, my glory. Okay, he's bringing salvation for Israel. That's Isaiah 46, 13. Isaiah 49, 6. Indeed, he says, it is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles that you may be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Okay, that includes Israel and the Gentiles. It's a small thing to only have Israel. We're going to have the nations there too, but to the ends of the earth, all his salvation will be offered to, including, of course, Israel. Jeremiah 3:23 says, truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the multitude of mountains. Truly, the Lord our God is the salvation of Israel. In Jeremiah 23:6, in his days, this is a reference to Christ, actually, in the previous verse, Isaiah 23:5. But in Isaiah 23:6, it says, in his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell safely. Now, this is his name by which he'll be called Yahweh Tzidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. It's a prophecy about Jesus. In his days, Israel will be saved. Judah will be saved. Well, what happened? He came. How come they didn't get saved? Jeremiah 30 and verse 10. Therefore, do not fear, O my servant Jacob, says the Lord, nor be dismayed, O Israel, for behold, I will save you. Okay, salvation is promised to Israel. Jeremiah 46, 27. But do not fear, O my servant Jacob, and do not be dismayed, O Israel, for behold, I will save you. Again, twice he says that in Jeremiah. In Zechariah 8:13. Zechariah 8:13 says, it shall come to pass that just as you were a curse among the nations, O house of Judah and house of Israel, so I will save you, and you shall be a blessing. Do not fear, let your hands be strong. How many times does God have to say it? He's going to save Israel. I will save you, Israel. The Lord shall save Israel. Israel will be saved in the Lord with an everlasting salvation. This is a repeated promise of the Old Testament. Israel had every reason to expect the Messiah to come and save them. The Messiah came, and they didn't get saved. What's up with that? And that's what Paul raises in verse 6, Romans 9, 6. He says, it's not that the word of God has taken no effect. Now, that means it's not that the word of God has failed to come true. But it has not failed to come true. His argument is it has happened. It has not failed to happen. It has happened. But how in the world can you say it's happened? If Israel is to be saved and the majority of Jews are not followers of Christ and therefore not saved, how can you say that the word of God has not taken effect? It appears that it has not taken effect. He says, well, no, it's that not all are Israel who are of Israel. They are not all Israel who are of Israel. Now, here we have the word Israel used twice in the same sentence, different ways. The second Israel obviously refers to the whole race or the nation of Israel. Not all of them are really Israel. Now, the promises are made to Israel, but which Israel? What he's going to point out is it has never been the case that everybody who's ethnically Israel has been one of God's remnant people. And what Paul's going to go into in the remainder of the chapter, and further on even in chapter 11, is that God's Israel really just refers to the faithful remnant in Israel. In fact, if you look just for the moment, further on in this chapter, Romans 9, 27, he says, Isaiah also cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, the remnant will be saved. Okay, there's the promise. When God says he can save Israel, he's talking about the remnant, not all of them. Only the remnant will be saved. The others are like the sand of the sea for a multitude, but they're not saved. Only the remnant is saved. Paul is making it very clear. When God promised things to Israel, he was promising them to the faithful in Israel, not the unfaithful in Israel. Those who are not faithful are not Israel. They are not all Israel who are of Israel. There are many Jews descended from Israel, but they're not all the faithful remnant of Israel. And this is why Paul refers to the church in Galatians 6:16, he addresses the church as the Israel of God. God has an Israel, and he has, in fact, fulfilled his word to them. He has sent the Messiah, and they have become saved. They have received Christ. The ones who have received Christ are the ones who are saved, and they are the ones who are Israel. Those Jews who have rejected Christ are not the faithful. They are not saved because they're not really Israel. So Paul's argument right there in verse 6 is almost done. We don't have to really go any further to see what his argument is. God's promises to save Israel have not failed. They have materialized, in fact, because the ones who are the Israel he promised saved are not everybody who's Jewish. Not everybody who's racially Jewish is Israel. And the ones who are, he has in fact saved, as he promised to do in Christ. The faithful remnant of Israel are therefore those who are in Christ, the Jews who have received Christ. They're the Israel that is the smaller Israel within the larger Israel, which is just the race of Israel. We see in the Old Testament the same thing that Isaiah said when he said, though Israel's numbers like the sand of the seashore, only the remnant will be saved. It's very clear that God throughout the Old Testament had and recognized a remnant, a faithful group inside Israel to whom his promises applied. Those who were apostate, to them his promises did not apply. If you look at Psalm 50, verse 5, God says, gather my saints together with me, those who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. Now, God has people who are faithful to him, his saints. They're in a covenant relationship and they're honoring that covenant. But look down at verse 16. But to the wicked, God says, now these are not the Gentiles. These are the wicked among the Jews. To the wicked, he says, what right have you to declare my statutes or to take my covenant in your mouth, seeing you hate instruction and cast my words behind you? These people are not faithful to covenant. They're Jews because they do take his covenant on their mouth, as they claim to be his covenant people. Gentiles don't claim that. Gentiles didn't claim to be Yahweh's covenant people. That's Israel's special distinction. They have a covenant with Yahweh. But he says, you don't have any right to call yourself my covenant people. Why do you take my covenant on your mouth and talk that way? You hate me. You hate my instruction. You don't, this is not for you. You see, God made this distinction in the Old Testament between ethnic Israel as one category and the faithful remnant as a smaller category within them. And God, therefore, has not made a promise that every Jewish person will be saved, ever. Jews can be lost as well as Gentiles can be lost because there's no distinction between Jew and Gentile. Paul's labored to make that point earlier in Romans, and he's not changing his mind here. He's pointing out that he is not a Jew who's one outwardly. He is a Jew who's one inwardly. They're not all Israel in God's sight who are outwardly Israel. It's the inward Israel that is the true Israel, the Israel of God. God has, in fact, fulfilled his promise. He has not postponed it. So the dispensationalist believes that we're going to read Paul arguing this way. God has not fulfilled his word yet. He has still in mind to do so in the future. It's just not time yet. At the end of this age, God will fulfill his promises to Israel, and all Israel will then be saved, meaning ethnic Israel. All Israel will be saved. And yet Paul can't be saying that because he's already quoted in chapter 9, verse 27, only a remnant is going to be saved of Israel. Israel's may be a large group like the sand of the sea, but only the remnant will be saved. So Paul can't be saying all Jews will be saved because he's just said it isn't going to happen that way. So what is his point? His point is not there's been a postponement of the promise. His message is there's been a misunderstanding on the part of Israel of what the promise applies to. They think it applies to them just because they're Jewish. He says, no, you've got to be a Jew inwardly as well as outwardly. You can't be just an Israelite in race. You have to be an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile, like Nathanael. As we read on, Paul develops this, and it's very clear that this is his point. He says, God's word has not failed to take effect, for they are not all Israel who are of Israel, nor are they all children, meaning children of God or children of Abraham, considered indistinguishable from each other. They are not all children because they are the seed of Abraham, but in Isaac your seed shall be called. Now, what is that quote about? Why does he quote there, Genesis 21:12, in Isaac your seed will be called? Well, because Abram had more children than just Isaac. Before Isaac was born, Ishmael was a son of Abraham. And apparently at a later time, there were six more sons of Abraham because the book of Genesis talks about another woman that Abraham married, Keturah, and six more sons were born to him. Abraham had eight sons that we know of in his lifetime. All of them were technically the seed of Abraham, were they not? They all were his sons, according to the flesh. But God said to him, no, in Isaac your seed will be called. In other words, only Isaac is your seed. You got seven sons who are natural born children of yours who aren't your seed. I mean, they are, technically, but they don't count for anything. When God says your seed, he's talking about the seed that is the seed according to the promise. God had told Abraham, through your seed, all the nations of the world will be blessed. Well, Isaac is the one. The other seven are not. That special seed that's in special relationship with God, that God has special plans for, out of Abraham's eight children, one of them qualified. Seven others who had equal claim to being sons of Abraham in the natural sense, they had no claim to being Abraham's seed in the special sense. That's what he's saying. And what's the point of that? He's illustrating what he said in verse 6. They are not all Israel who are of Israel. You see, they are not even all the significant seed of Abraham who are the seed of Abraham. There were seven men besides Isaac, who are the seed of Abraham, but they weren't counted as the seed, and not all Israel is counted as Israel. There's always a selection within the family where God doesn't take them all on the same, doesn't make them all the same. One of them is chosen and not the others. Now, by the way, choosing, we need to be careful because most people mistakenly think that this means that God chose Isaac to go to heaven, and those other seven guys, they just missed out. They had to go to hell. There's no discussion about heaven and hell in this chapter. There's no discussion of that kind of salvation by this kind of selection. what is being selected here is, if God has made promises that one of Abraham's seed is going to bless all the nations, well, there's a whole bunch of people descended from Abraham. Which one? Well, Isaac, not the others. Isaac what? Isaac will be the one through whom all the nations will be blessed. Well, what about his personal salvation? Well, that's a separate issue. You know, if he dies in faith, he'll be saved too. But that's not the question we're talking about. We're not talking about who's being saved. We're talking about which one is going to fulfill the promises God made to Abraham. We're talking about God's selection of a chosen seed of Abraham, who would be the one through whom the promises God made will be fulfilled. Namely, that through that seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Now, of course, later in Galatians, or earlier, really, because Paul wrote Galatians earlier. But in Galatians, Paul said that promise wasn't made to seeds like many, but to your seed singular, which is Christ. In Galatians 3:16, Paul clarifies that the seed of Abraham through whom all the nations are blessed is Christ himself. Not all the Jews, not all the many seeds of Abraham, but the seed singular. But the seed that was significant in that way in the first generation after Abraham was his seed Isaac. In Isaac, your seed will be called. The others, they're just Gentiles. They got as much Abrahamic blood in them as Isaac has, but they're Gentiles and he's not. You see the point? Paul's pointing out you can be descended from Abraham or even Isaac and Jacob and still not be special. Being a Jew by race doesn't make you special. Being the one that God selected, that's what made him special. Isaac did not qualify as seed of Abraham on a biological basis any more than the other seven half-brothers he had. They were all the same in terms of their biological connection to Abraham, equal. But in God's selection, not. God chose Isaac. And then, let's go a further generation, but not yet. Verse 8, that is, those who are the children of the flesh, which just means those who are physically descended from Abraham, like Jews claim to be, well, that doesn't count for anything. These are not the children of God, but the children of the promise, like Isaac, were counted as the seed. So Paul here, in showing that they are not all Israel who are of Israel, points out that they are not all of Abraham who are of Abraham. Remember Jesus said in John chapter 8 to the Jews who didn't believe in him, he said, I know that you're Abraham's descendants. This is John 8:37. Jesus said, I know that you are Abraham's descendants, but you seek to kill me. And in verse 39, he says, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. Now, they were descended from Abraham. They were his descendants. They were children of the flesh, physically descended. But he said, if you were really Abraham's children, and by this he must certainly mean the children of Abraham that to whom the promises apply. Well, you're not that. You would be doing the works of Abraham if you were that. You can be Abraham's descendants, but not Abraham's children in the sense that counts for anything with God. So Jesus said what Paul's saying. Those Pharisees, those people criticizing him, they were Jewish as much as Jesus was Jewish. As much as the disciples were Jewish, they were Jewish. But they weren't Abraham's children in the sense that counts for inheritance, in the sense that counts for God's special relationship with them, for being the ones that were promised. Okay, that's what Jesus said. John the Baptist had said the same thing or taught the same thing in an earlier time, because in Matthew 3:9, John the Baptist speaking to an entirely Jewish audience, he said, do not think to say within yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. Well, that's exactly what they said. That was their claim to specialness. We are the seed of Abraham. We have Abraham as our father. He said, don't even talk like that. He said, that doesn't make a difference. He says, for I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Now, these stones aren't all that special. They're just mineral. But if God wanted, he could turn them into children of Abraham. So don't think you've got some special status just because you say you're children of Abraham. Now, think about it for a moment. Could God make biological children of Abraham from the stones? No, he'd have to change all history. Those stones have a different background. They didn't come from Abraham. They came from a mountainside somewhere, or a quarry or something. They have no ancestral connection to Abraham, but he could make them children of Abraham in the sense that counts. because you don't have to be Jewish. You don't have to be physically descended from Abraham, like those stones were not. God could still make you a child of Abraham in the sense that counts. And we know what that sense is, because in Galatians 3, Paul said, only those who are of faith are the children of Abraham. And he also said in Galatians 3, he said, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed. And he's writing to mostly Gentiles. So you could, God can make you a child of Abraham, even if you have no lineage going back to Abraham. Gentiles don't, stones don't. But in the sense that makes a difference that you might as well talk about, it doesn't require lineage back to Abraham. And that kind of lineage back to Abraham isn't worth talking about, because it's just a racial distinction. If God was a racist, it might matter, but he's not a racist. And therefore, whatever race you are is not going to make a difference in terms of eternity. Now, true, God made selections within the family of Abraham as to which branch of the family was going to bring the Messiah into the world, but even not all of them were saved in all likelihood. When you read the ancestors of Christ in Matthew's gospel, some of them were people who were kings who were apostate, evil kings. There's no reason to believe they were saved, but they were chosen as descendants of David to be in the ancestry of Christ. The chosenness of Abram's seed is that they would bring forth the Messiah. A person who is in that lineage that brought forth the Messiah might not be personally saved themselves. This is not talking about personal salvation. This is talking about God's choice of who is in the seed, who is the chosen one that's going through bringing forth the seed. And so there were even people who weren't personally, saved, it would seem, who were in Christ's lineage. And they were the ones in their generation that were chosen by God to bring forth the next generation leading to the Messiah. Their children and their grandchildren and so forth led to the Messiah. They were chosen for that, but not chosen for salvation. Salvation's a different issue. That's not decided on a racial basis. It's not even chosen on a unilateral choice of God. I think I'll save you and not you. God makes choices like that for vocation, for importance of what you'll accomplish in this world and whether you'll fit into his plan in the world. He can choose Cyrus, to fulfill his purpose in letting the Jews go home to their land without saving the man personally. We have to make a distinction, as Paul does, and certainly as the Old Testament does, between being chosen to fulfill God's earthly purposes on the one hand, and the idea of being chosen for salvation, which is how most people read Paul here. Now, he's not saying that Isaac was saved eternally and Ishmael went to hell. We have no reason to believe that Ishmael was not saved in that sense. Ishmael seemed to be a believer also. He just wasn't selected to be the one whose children would bring forth the Messiah. Let's face it, everyone in the world except Isaac was passed over for that. That doesn't make Ishmael a uniquely bad person or damned. Lots of people died in faith, but were not in the ancestral lineage of Jesus. The choices here are not choice for salvation, but choice for God's purpose to be fulfilled through your family line. He chose Isaac, not Ishmael or the others. And then within Isaac's family, he made a selection too. Because it says, I'm not quite there yet. I have to get to verse 10 for that, but we have to do verse 8 and 9. He says, the ones who are the children of Abraham according to the flesh, they're not the true children of God. Those who are the children of the promise are counted as the seed. For this is the word of the promise, at this time I will come and Sarah shall have a son. Now what he's saying there, he's quoting Genesis 18:10. What he's saying is Isaac was a son of Abraham sort of on a different basis than the others. The others were just children of the flesh. There was nothing miraculous involved. Abram mated with women and they had babies, just like generally happens when men and women mate. That was very natural. All of Abram's other seed were natural. Isaac, however, only existed because God promised that he would. Isaac was produced despite nature, against nature, and therefore Isaac was simply the fulfillment of a promise and the child of promise. And so he quotes the promise. At this time, I'll come again and Sarah will have a son. Well, that's Isaac. God promised that Sarah would have a son. So the son is a child of promise. Now, interestingly, if you hold your finger there and look over at Galatians 4, Paul uses the term children of promise and children of the flesh with reference to Abraham's children again. In Galatians 4, verse 21, Paul says, tell me you who desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? meaning the Torah. And so he's going to tell us a story from the Torah, Genesis to be precise. For it is written that Abraham had two sons. Actually, he had more, but these two are the ones that he wants to make a point about. The one by a bondwoman, the other by a free woman, clearly Ishmael and Isaac. The one who was of the bondwoman, that is Ishmael, was born according to the flesh. No miracle there. His mother was young enough to have children, and Abraham was able to impregnate her. That's just physical children. He of the free woman, that is Isaac, was through promise. So now he's made a distinction. Abraham had two sons, and not only two sons, but two kinds of sons. Sons of the flesh and sons of promise. Two categories. The same categories Paul has mentioned in Romans 9 and made a distinction. In Romans 9, he said, they who are the children of the flesh, they're not the children of God, but those who are the children of the promise. Now, later on in this scripture, it says in verse 28, Galatians 4:28, now we, brethren, Jew and Gentile Christians, Paul and his Gentile readers, we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of the promise. But as he who was born according to the flesh then persecuted him who was born according to the Spirit. Now, being born of the promise is now substitute for born of the Spirit, which begins to specify more the Christian reborn person. We're the children of the promise. We're the ones that are Abraham's true children. But Ishmael persecuted Isaac, and so also, he says, so does it happen now. The Jew, who's the natural born descendant of Abraham, like Ishmael was, persecutes those who are born of the Spirit or born of the promise. That's us. Paul's saying the Jews persecute the church, which they were in fact doing. Paul was always being persecuted by the Jews. Nevertheless, what does the scripture say? Verse 30, Galatians 4:30. What's the scripture say? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. This is actually a quote of Sarah. Sarah said this to Abraham. Paul takes it as the word of the Lord to Abraham. Sarah spoke scripture. Cast out the bondwoman and her son. Hagar and Ishmael cast out of the family. Why? Because Ishmael, the son of the bondwoman, will not be heir. We could say the son of the flesh will not be heir with the son of the promise. The heirs to Abraham's promises are the children of the promise, not the children of the flesh. Ishmael being an example of a child of the flesh who was excluded. Isaac, a child of the promise, included. Paul's point is, you can talk about being a child of Abraham one of two ways. If you're a Jew, you can say you're a child of Abraham. But that's just in the flesh. And even John the Baptist said, even God could make stones into children of Abraham that are, you know, better than you. So don't boast about being children of Abraham. Jesus said, I know you're descended from Abraham, but if you're the children of Abraham, you'd do the works of Abraham. Very clearly, Jesus, John the Baptist, Paul, they all make the point. Being Jewish itself counts for nothing. God does not have a favorite race of people. He has some favorite people, but they're not based on their race, but on their being his children by faith. Now, back to Romans 9 on this matter. He has pointed out that Isaac was a child of the promise because God promised Sarah would have a child, and that was why Isaac showed up. And that's contrary to Ishmael, who is just a child of the flesh. So they are types of two types of children of Abraham. Those who are born because of the promise, and you and I, not being Jewish, would never have been able to be children of Abraham, just like Isaac wouldn't by nature, because Isaac came through a miracle. Neither Abraham nor Sarah were able to parent children, and a miracle caused Isaac to be a child of Abraham when he wouldn't naturally be able to. We wouldn't naturally be able to either, because we have different parentage. Gentiles would never be children of Abraham, except because of God's promise, I've made you a father of many nations. Well, we're some of those nations, Gentiles, whom he has become the father. The promise that he would also have Gentile children is why we are his children. We're not children of the flesh. We're children because of the promise. And he says in verse 10, he takes it a step further. Now we've got Isaac identified as the child of the promise as opposed to his half-brothers. Let's go further. Isaac's family, he had two sons and a wife named Rebekah. It says, not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one man, even our father Isaac, for the children not yet being born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls, it was said to her, the older shall serve the younger, and, as it is written, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Now, Jacob and Esau were the two sons born to Rebecca. And Paul emphasizes she became pregnant by one man. Now, of course, women never become pregnant by two men at the same time, but the emphasis on him being one man means they both had the same father. Isaac was the chosen seed, but that doesn't mean all of his children were the chosen seed. He fathered two children at once, and only one of them was the chosen seed. The other was not, which again is interesting because Esau had every bit as much claim to be a natural son or grandson of Abraham as Jacob had. As far as physical birth and lineage is concerned, there's not a dime's worth of difference between Jacob and Esau. They had exactly the same parentage. They were sons of Abraham and Isaac. But only one was chosen to be the seed. Now, this passage is very often quoted by Calvinists for their doctrine of unconditional election, because God made a choice not based on conditions. It's before they did good or bad. They were still in the womb. They couldn't earn anything. They couldn't qualify for anything. God didn't look at some better quality in Jacob and say, I'm picking him. His choice of Jacob is declared to be unconditional. Jacob and Esau had neither done good nor bad, but the choice was done this way so that it would be God's election, not their merits. That made the choice. That's what Paul says. Now, the reason the Calvinist likes this is there's no other place in the Bible that says that election is unconditional. There's many places in the Bible that talk about God choosing, but it never says he chose unconditionally. In fact, again and again, it says that those who honor him, he will honor. Those who despise him, he will lightly esteem. The Bible again and again says he gives grace to the humble and resists the proud. God makes his selection of who are his people, that is his true people in an eternal sense, children. He makes it based on very, very well-stated conditions. They have to humble themselves, not be proud. He'll resist the proud and give grace to the humble. They have to honor him and he'll honor them. The Bible does not teach that God chooses on an unconditional basis. It doesn't teach that anywhere except here. And that's why this verse, more than any other, is the Calvinist's favorite verse for unconditional election. The only problem they have here, though, and they don't seem to know that they have it, is this is not about God choosing some people to be saved and some people to be lost. This is not what is being chosen here. Esau was not the one selected, but we are never told that Esau didn't get saved. True, he made some mistakes, and we're warned not to make the same mistake he did of selling his birthright, but that birthright wasn't the birthright to go to heaven. His birthright was that he would be the one through whom the Messiah would come. He forfeited that because he made a very poor choice. He chose instant gratification for food and sold away his right to be the one that the Messiah would come through. Okay, so that put him in what condition? Damned? No, in the same condition as anybody else who isn't in the lineage of the Messiah. Only one person per generation can be in that lineage. All other people are not. But that doesn't mean all other people are lost. Sometime around this time, Job lived. He wasn't in the lineage of the Messiah either. But he was certainly saved by faith. Esau might have been also. Though Esau's mistake is presented to us as something to avoid and not emulate, he made that mistake relatively young. Later in life, we see him on good terms with Jacob. He's forgiven Jacob for cheating him. They join together to honor their father in burial and so forth. I mean, you don't really see it that Esau ends up being a really bad guy. For all we know, he may have died a believer. He might be in heaven today, but he wasn't chosen to be the one through whom the Messiah would come. These choices that are being made in the family of Abraham and Isaac and eventually Jacob, they're not choices about salvation. That's not what's being discussed here. What Paul's trying to point out is, if you want to know who Israel is, it's always been a smaller number than those who could claim physical descent from Abraham or Isaac, or Jacob for that matter. We just have to extrapolate that if you kept going another generation, it'd be the same thing. That he's talking about, he takes the first and second generation and extrapolates that's true to this day. No matter how many generations you get away from Abraham, it's still true. There's going to be some who are the children of the promise and some who are not. But of course, now that Christ has come and he is the seed, it also does involve personal salvation. When you come into Christ and you become Abraham's seed, you're saved in him. There's a lot of other benefits besides being the one through whom the nations will be blessed. Now, God could presumably bless the nations through someone who didn't even go to heaven. I don't know if he's ever done that, and I'm not sure I have any biblical precedent for that, but theoretically, nothing could prevent God from doing that if he wanted to. If he had a person that wasn't even saved, he could use Osiris to deliver the Jews from Babylon. He could use another pagan to bring the message of salvation somewhere if he wanted to. It could happen. He just hasn't chosen to do that. He's doing it through those who are in Christ, who happen to also be saved. So being now children of the promise also connects with being saved in a bigger sense. Salvation in the eternal sense now becomes part and parcel of being the seed of Abraham, because Christ is the seed of Abraham, and you can't be in him without being saved in the eternal sense. But still, the chosenness is not a chosenness for salvation. God has chosen those who are in Christ for what? For the same thing he chose anyone else for, to be the ones to bring the blessing to the whole nations. The only reason Abram was selected at all was so that all the nations of the world could someday be blessed with the gospel, with justification by faith. If you read Galatians 3, Paul makes it very clear. The blessing of Abraham comes to the nations. And what is it? It's the blessing of justification by faith through Christ. Abraham existed, Isaac existed, Jacob existed, all the Jewish race existed so that this seed of Abraham could be brought into the world, and that's Christ, and through him all the nations will be blessed. How's that? Those of us who are in Christ are dispatched. The church in Christ, the body of Christ, is dispatched to bring this blessing, the gospel, to all nations. So there were people in Jesus' lineage who never were saved and are probably not in heaven today. But they still had a role in bringing the salvation to the world, the earthly role. And that's what the choice of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is focused on here. There's an earthly role that Israel had. But even in that earthly role, not everyone who's a child of the flesh is a participant. God has always chosen for special purposes a smaller group within the larger race. Now, by the way, we're gonna wind this down, but I need to deal with verses 12 and 13. That's where we'll quit here. Because this choice of Jacob over Esau is backed up with two scriptures. One of them is from Genesis, here in verse 12. He quotes Genesis 25, 23, where God said, "The older shall serve the younger." Now, the context of this is Rebekah was pregnant with twins. There was a disturbance inside her womb. They were fighting it out. And she thought, what is going on? And so it says she went and she inquired of the Lord. I don't know where she went to inquire of the Lord. I don't know if there was a prophet somewhere or whatever. But she got a word from the Lord somehow. And the Lord said to her, two nations are in your womb. Two peoples shall come forth from between your feet. One shall be greater than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. The older what? Nation. This is a prophecy about nations, not individuals. The prediction is not about the individuals. It's about the nations. And nations serve earthly purposes. There's no whole nation that's going to heaven that is earthly political nation. This is not a prediction about anyone going to heaven or hell. This is saying there's going to be one nation and not another one that's going to bring the Messiah into the world and fulfill God's purposes. That's going to be the Jewish nation. That's Jacob's offspring. The other nation, Esau's nation, is the Edomites. They're not going to be doing that. They're going to be serving Jacob. Esau came out first, Jacob second. So Esau is technically the older, but he's going to serve the younger one. Esau is going to serve Jacob. Now, we know for sure this isn't about individuals, because the man Esau never did serve Jacob, not one moment. Esau and Jacob had separate adult lives. They were hardly ever together. But when they were together, Jacob bowed to Esau seven times. We never see Esau ever bow to Jacob or serve him. If this is a prophecy about individuals, it's a false prophecy. But if it's a prophecy about nations, Jacob's nation is going to rule over Esau's nation. Well, then that's true. And it is about nations, because the prophecy begins with the words, two nations are in your womb. So we're not seeing individual destinies here at all. We're seeing which branch of the family the Jacob branch or the Esau branch is going to be carrying on this earthly role of bringing the Messiah. And many of those of Jacob's descendants who were used to bring it were not saved themselves. So this is not choices for salvation. This is choices for fulfilling the Abrahamic promise of bringing a Messiah into the world. And to use this as some kind of a unconditional election of some people to get saved and some not to, there's two problems with that. One, it's not about individuals, it's about nations. Secondly, it's not about salvation. It's about earthly significance. And you can even see that. What does Paul quote? The older shall serve the younger. What in the world does that have about heaven and hell? Are they suggesting that maybe Esau in hell will serve Jacob? Or in heaven? What are they talking about? No, this is talking about the earthly roles of these men's offspring as nations, the Edomites and the Jews. Edom would serve the Jews. That's earthly. This would be a terrible verse to quote if you're trying to say something about heaven and hell, salvation and damnation. There's no hint of it in the verse. Then he quotes another verse. This time, he's quoting Malachi 1, verses 2 and 3. And in that verse, God says, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Now, this verse was not made at the same time as the previous verse. Paul's quoting one verse from Genesis at the beginning of the Old Testament, and the other from Malachi at the end of the Old Testament. And he's pointing out that whichever place you look, you'll see that Jacob was favored over Esau, though both of them technically had the same parentage. They were both equally sons of Abraham and of Isaac, for that matter, in the flesh. But Esau was certainly the one that was not chosen. And so this is simply making the point that God does not favor everyone who's got the right bloodline. These men had equal bloodlines and they had entirely different destinies earthly-wise. Now, loved and hated, first of all, once again, this is talking about nations. In Malachi, Esau and Jacob were long dead. But what God is saying in Malachi 1 is, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated, and I wasted his hills, Esau's hills. That means Edom's hills. That is what God is saying. If you read the context of Malachi, it's after the return of the exiled Jews from Babylon. He's saying, I did something for Jacob, that is for the Jews, that I did not do for Esau, that is the Edomites. Both nations were destroyed by Babylon some 70 years or more earlier. The Edomites and the Jews were both conquered by Babylon. One difference, though, is that the nation of Israel was restored from that captivity. Edom never was. And God is pointing to this. You think I haven't shown you favored treatment? Look what I did. You had a brother nation, the Edomites. They were equally related to Abraham and Isaac as you. But I wiped them out and didn't bring them back. I wiped you up, but I brought you back. I've shown special favor to you that I did not show to them. That's what it means. I've loved Jacob and hated Esau. As you read through the Old Testament, you find that the nation of Israel is often called Jacob. And the nation of Edom is often called Edom or Esau. Actually, Edom is even the man's name. Esau was also called Edom. The man was. The nations are named after their progenitors. So there's two nations came from Rebekah. One was the Jacob nation. The other was Esau nation. And God, even at the late date in Malachi, says, I've shown my favoritism toward Jacob. I've restored his nation from captivity. I have not done that for Esau. You see my favoritism here. Now, favoritism, yes, in terms of national destinies, not eternal destinies. Edomites could be saved. There are a number of Edomites. In fact, Job probably was an Edomite. The indication would be he probably was Edomite. At least some of his friends were. But there are Edomites later in the story of Israel who were faithful to Yahweh, apparently converts to Judaism. But the Edomites aren't doomed to hell for being Edomites, and the Jews aren't destined for heaven for being Jews. Heaven and hell are not given away as prizes or punishments for being of the certain race. But both Jacob and Esau came from Abraham and Isaac, and they had very different callings and destinies. I have hated and I have loved is simply a comparative term. It doesn't sound like it in our language, but in the Bible, repeatedly, hatred and love are contrasted in context where all that's really being said is, I favored this one over the other one. The obvious examples. Jacob had two wives, Rachel and Leah. It says he loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. The next verse says God saw that he hated Leah. Hated? He had seven children by the woman. How could it be said he hated her in the sense we mean it? No, it says in the previous verse he loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. And therefore he hated Leah in the sense that hatred is being used here. It's an idiom of the Hebrews that is different than the way we do. Jesus said you must hate your father and mother and wife and children in Luke chapter 14, if you're going to follow me. But in Matthew 10, where the parallel is, he says, if you love father or mother more than me, you're not worthy of me. If you love wife or children more than me, you're not worthy of me. So hate them means don't love them more than me. Hatred and love are simply comparative terms. I favored Jacob. I did not show the same favoritism toward Esau. Or in the typical Hebraism, I loved Jacob, hated Esau. It's not such a strong statement against Esau as it might sound to our ears. It's simply saying God made a difference and favored one over the other, and he certainly did. But it's talking about nations, not individuals. Of course he favored individuals too, but that's not even being brought up by Paul, because he's not talking about unconditional election for salvation. He's talking about how God throughout history has taken the Jewish family and reduced it, in every generation has reduced it to some who were the ones he was pleased with and going to use, and the rest who he was not going to use. And this is going to move toward, you know, further demonstrating that they are not all Israel who are of Israel. And therefore that the promises of God to Israel are fulfilled in that smaller selected group, not the whole nation. And we'll have to wait until next time to pick up that thought again.